And check, 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 check.
Hi, Evan.
Good evening, everybody. I think we'll start. Good evening and welcome. Thank you, and thank you very much for coming this evening. My name is Chris Wright. I'm the Managing Director of Infrastructure for Eminent Public Schools. We're very pleased that everybody... Thank you. How's that? My name is Chris Wright. I'm the Managing Director of Infrastructure for Eminent Public Schools. Sorry if that's a repeat already. Thank you very much for coming this evening. We sure appreciate your time. I'd like to make a couple of quick introductions before we get going. First of all, welcome to Trustee Orville Chubb, Trustee for Ward C, this area. Welcome to Councillor Andrew Knack from City Council. For representing Eminent Public Schools, on behalf of the Superintendent of Schools, Dr. Lauren Parker, the Executive Director of Infrastructure with the district, Assistant Superintendent Ron McNeil, and I'd like to also acknowledge, is Principal Rick Ramsey around for hosting this evening? Thank you, Principal Ramsey, probably busy hosting. And thank you all again for attending. Our conversation tonight falls under the larger umbrella of the district's infrastructure plan. And through the infrastructure plan, we have the opportunity to make sure that we're doing the best we can to support the excellent teaching and learning that goes on at Brightview and Mayfield and Youngstown and Britannia schools, and in fact, all schools in the district. And our scope involves not only ensuring that we have high quality learning environments for students in all parts of the city, but also how programs are distributed. We're preparing to make sure that we're able to accommodate all of our high school kids when they reach high school. We're making sure that all of our early years programming is in different parts of the city, as many as possible, and so on. But this evening's presentation and discussions that will follow represent a start to a very important conversation about your community. A start that will help to set context and provide some preliminary data for discussions. But the most important part of this evening is to begin collecting your feedback. We look forward to hearing your vision and aspirations for the future direction of your school and broader community. These initial conversations will be followed up with conversations later this spring, where a more detailed look at data, options, and needs can take place. We know some of you will be looking for a wide range of specifics this evening, but we encourage you to engage in discussion and provide feedback about a larger picture. We're committed to a sincere process and are intent on making sure that all voices are heard. And I'd like to take a moment to welcome the Honorable, did you want to get seated? The Honorable Sarah Hoffman, Deputy Premier, Minister of Health, and the MLA for Edmonton Glenora, welcome.
Sorry, I'm late.
And with that, I'd like to invite Kim Holowatic to begin a brief presentation, including more information about next steps this evening and in the coming months. Kim, thank you.
Good evening. Welcome. Is that loud enough? Are we good? Thanks. I'm very excited to be here tonight to begin a dialogue around great learning spaces for kids. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedules to share in these discussions this evening. I'm going to begin with a short video that will set the context for the discussions that we're going to have here tonight.
At Edmonton Public Schools, we're proud of the role we have in shaping our city's future, transforming the learners of today into the leaders of tomorrow. With more than 93,000 students spread across more than 200 schools, it's a big job. And wherever they live in our city, all our students deserve great teachers, a great education, and high-quality learning environments. We want to make sure our students are in spaces that have the latest technology, are accessible for all students and staff, and have classrooms that can be used for many purposes and programs. But it's no secret we're facing a serious challenge. We've experienced huge enrollment growth in the last few years. While many students are living in new areas of the city that need new schools, we also have students living in mature communities attending older schools, which creates some unique challenges. As these older schools reach their intended lifespan, they become more expensive to maintain. Most of our mature schools are more than 50 years old, and it would cost more than what we could afford to repair or upgrade them. And with fewer students in an older building, there's less funding available to provide great programming and keep the school in great condition for our students. So it's time to take action and work together to make decisions about public education in your community. And we need your help to get it right. That's why we're reaching out to you and the people in your community so we can better understand your needs. We want to know, what kind of school works for you in terms of grades and classroom spaces? What kinds of educational programming would you like to see? What unique needs does your community have? We'll gather your feedback and come back to continue the conversation. We'll work together to come up with ideas about how to create the best learning spaces possible for the students in your neighborhood. By working with Edmontonians like you in communities across our city, we're helping put all our students on a path to success in a new or fully modernized school as close to their home community as possible. Because at the end of the day, we want your children to be successful in school. And we're looking forward to working with you to help make that happen. For more information and to share your ideas, visit spaceforstudents.epsb.ca.
To give you a little bit of background, our district has been working on an infrastructure plan with the end goal of having all students, no matter where they live, receiving an excellent education in the best learning environment possible. The plan must also address the challenges our district is facing in terms of enrollment and aging buildings, and the cost not only to fix or maintain them, but to provide the best learning spaces for our leaders of tomorrow. A few key points begin to illustrate these challenges. Last year, we had almost 30,000 unused spaces across the district. Unused equals unfunded, yet the space must be maintained. In the next 2 years, we will open 13 new schools, and this will add another 10,000 student spaces. These new schools will provide local accommodation for students in communities currently without a school. As students move out of their current schools into new spaces closer to home, the number of unused spaces in our mature communities will continue to grow. Again, unused equals unfunded. On an annual basis, the district spends approximately 25% more to operate and maintain space than is provided in funding. This money must come from somewhere. So it is often redirected away from the classroom and the instruction of students toward operational costs and general maintenance. As I mentioned, the goal of the infrastructure plan is to provide high-quality teaching and learning spaces for all students across our district. Maintaining and modernizing all of our schools is simply not possible. Current provincial funding addresses only a small portion of our infrastructure deficit, and as this deficit grows, the funding received will address even less. We are here tonight to begin looking at how we might achieve the goal of great learning spaces for kids while being fiscally responsible about how education dollars are spent. A school is viewed as the heart of a community, and we fully understand and support that belief. New or fully modernized schools can not only address our challenges, but provide long-term public investment in a community. We believe such an investment has the potential to jumpstart other renewal efforts as well. So what do we mean when we talk about high-quality learning environments? Research points to the fact that there is a correlation between student success and well-being and the environment in which they learn. How does proper lighting, air quality, or temperature regulation affect you in your place of work and in your home. Remove these issues for students, and there are less distractions and more focused learning will take place. Our schools were built at a time when accommodating persons of varying abilities was not considered. We need to ensure that students of all abilities can be welcomed and accommodated in all of our schools. Older schools do not allow for the technological infrastructure necessary for 21st century learning. And as our curriculum evolves and changes to meet the needs of our ever-changing world, learning spaces require more flexibility to adapt and change. Here is an example of one of our newer district schools. Notice the bright, welcoming atmosphere. The photo in the lower right corner is a multi-purpose space with movable walls. Close it up and it acts as an enclosed modern foods lab. Open it up and it serves as a multi-purpose space in the heart of the school that can be used as a gathering space for students at lunch, an area for large project work, space for multiple classes to collaborate, or for special school events and community use space. The mechanical room, as you can see, functions much more cleanly and efficiently than our older schools with outdated boiler systems. Here we have an example of a fully modernized school near our city center. Improvements in lighting, mechanical systems, and accessibility were made while maintaining the historic elements of a treasured building. These examples are intended to begin to demonstrate the possibilities of a new or fully modernized facility in your greater community, possibilities that we are hoping to explore through this consultation process. There are no predetermined outcomes, nor funding promised. We truly are here at the very beginning of a process to walk hand in hand with you to come up with a plan that makes sense. So how were the clusters of schools determined? We began with an analysis of each of our planning sectors across the city, with a focus on enrollment and space utilization. This led us to the west and north central areas, as they have the lowest numbers of resident students and the highest number of unused spaces. Our infrastructure plan will address these issues in all mature areas of our city over the next few years. We grouped the schools according to junior high catchment area so as not to disrupt feeder patterns and to keep families and communities whole. High schools were not included, as they are being addressed through our high school accommodation plan, which is another branch of our larger infrastructure plan. For each cluster of schools, we looked at several things. We looked at enrollment in each of the schools. We looked at the programs offered. Who is attending these schools and programs, and where they reside? We looked at the current capacity of each of the schools according to the provincial model for measuring capacity, known as Instructional Area Model, or IAM. General facility condition of each school building was looked at. However, more detailed assessments are currently underway and will be shared at our meetings in May. Lastly, we looked at the number of unused student spaces in each school. This last point is an interesting one, because when you walk into a school and look around, it may appear that all the spaces are being used, but are they? Like our homes, there are spaces that are underutilized, like our formal living rooms, dining rooms, and our spare bedrooms for occasional guests. These are nice to have, but there's costs associated with operating them. Funding in a school is determined by the number of students enrolled. So when we have fewer students, the money available to run and maintain the space is spread out further. Our Britannia cluster consists of four schools geographically located within a 400 hectare area. Brightview, Mayfield, and Youngstown Elementary and Britannia Junior High School. Britannia and Youngstown schools currently receive students kindergarten to grade 9 from the developing neighborhood of Secord, west of Winterburn Road. This designation will end in September 2017 when two new schools will open in that area. Students will move out of Youngstown and Britannia schools to attend closer to home. The schools in this cluster community accommodate a variety of regular, special needs, and alternative programs and serve many students from outside of the area. All of these programs will be reviewed through this process we are beginning here tonight, or as part of the larger, more comprehensive review of program distribution across our district as part of the larger infrastructure plan. Today's urban planning practices are very different than they were back when these schools were built. I share this slide for comparison purposes only, and not to suggest a predetermined outcome of consolidating 4 schools into 1. That may not be the best solution for this cluster. We believe that there are many viable options to be discovered and explored through this consultation process. Here we have an area that serves 4 distinct city neighborhoods and is roughly the same size as the Britannia cluster area. We can use this to compare things like the number of students served and the operational and maintenance costs. The 4 schools in the Britannia area have an average age of 56 years, which would suggest that they are in need of infrastructure maintenance renewal or a major modernization investment. Again, detailed facility assessments are currently underway so that we can better understand these costs. Utility and other maintenance costs are roughly double when compared to a new facility. Other larger costs, such as outstanding major repairs and staffing, need to be considered. It is critical that I remind you, we are not predetermining a single replacement school. We feel the comparison is helpful to understand some of our infrastructure challenges, all within the context of respecting our infrastructure planning principles of accountability, equitable access, centers for educational excellence, environmental stewardship, and fiscal responsibility. We want to be certain that we are placing the greatest possible educational resources in each classroom across the city. This is the historical enrollment of the schools in the Britannia cluster dating back to 1967. As you can see, enrollment in all of the schools has declined over time. The data shows a few spikes in enrollment, which generally coincide with the introduction of new programs or neighborhoods to the attendance area. Youngstown School, in purple, has shown an increase in the last few years due to the addition of the Secord neighborhood to the attendance area and relocation of the Logos program into the school. The recent increase in Mayfield, shown in green, is the success of the early education program, which draws pre-kindergarten students with special needs from across the west and into the north areas of the city. Brightview in blue and Britannia in red show typical trends for community schools in a mature area. After an initial decline, once a neighborhood peaks, enrollment stabilizes at a number more suitable for the demographics of the area. These bar charts show adjusted enrollment and school capacity. We are using adjusted enrollment because this is what the province uses when evaluating the space in our schools. Adjusted enrollment means that any severe special needs student is counted as 3, and all kindergarten and pre-kindergarten students are counted as 0.5. The blue bar represents the adjusted number of students living in each attendance area. The green bar represents the adjusted number of students enrolled in each school. The red bar is the total capacity of each school building. At Brightview School, the residency and enrollment numbers are very similar, meaning that most students in that area attend the local school. There is, however, a large gap between the number of students enrolled and capacity of the school. At Britannia School, there are fewer students enrolled in the school than live in the area. This may be due to the students attending programs of choice in other areas of the city. At Mayfield School, the enrollment bar is a bit misleading, as Mayfield houses a large early education program. Most of these children are aged 2.5 to 5, coded as severe special needs and in a half-day program, which results in a weighting of 2.5 per child. This program draws students in from an area larger than the Mayfield attendance area, hence the difference between the blue and red bars. Youngstown's enrollment is slightly higher due to the accommodation of students from the Secord neighborhood and Logos program, which draws from an attendance area larger than the Youngstown area. I will note that the Secord neighborhood is not included in the residency number for Youngstown and Britannia schools, as these areas will be redirected to new schools opening in September 2017. Overall, the data in the top bar graph tells us that if we were to accommodate all of the students currently living in the Britannia cluster area, we would be less than half full. Even with the existing early years alternative and special needs programs in these sites, the total cluster is only 57% utilized. Maintaining all four schools in their current state is simply not an option going forward. Our conversations tonight and going forward need to be focused on creating the best learning spaces and programming for the students of the Britannia Cluster community. This includes looking at the concept of community in a new, expanded way. As you can see on the screen, there are many options to be explored. We could consider replacing two schools with one brand new or modernized school and retain two schools. We could consider replacing three schools with one brand new or modernized school and retain one school. We could consider replacing four schools with two brand new or modernized schools. I could go on. In this area, we wouldn't recommend a 4-to-1 scenario, as we do not feel that a school of this size with the current programming and grade configurations would be best for kids. That being said, we could look at whether the programs located within this cluster area are appropriate and serve the students residing here, or if some of them should be moved elsewhere. We are here to gather your feedback on the type of programming you want and need for your children. We need to get it right. Another idea to be explored is changing the traditional K-6, 7-9 grade groupings. What if we expanded the very successful early years programming and created an early years center to accommodate children pre-kindergarten through grade 1? A second school could accommodate grades 2-9. Another idea is to look at K-4 and 5-9 school models. These models are being used successfully in other Alberta school districts and across the United States. These are just some of the ideas that we feel are worth exploring, and we are certain that you will bring us many more. At the end of the day, we just want our students to have access to the best learning environments and programming possible. In 2014, we first engaged communities around a replacement school concept. The provincial government announced funding for a new replacement school in a mature area that would include the consolidation of three schools into one kindergarten to grade 9 school. We just needed to figure out where. Feedback from the Lawton cluster area indicated support for the proposal, and the new Ivor Dent School will open in the Beverly neighborhood on the Rundle School site in September of 2017. The Highlands Area Cluster indicated support for the concept, but wanted to explore a different model. A community working committee was established that included principals, parents, and community representatives. The committee worked for 5 months to develop design options for either a new school building or a full modernization and addition to an existing building that would meet the programming needs of children residing in the area. Working with an architect, 3 design concepts were developed by the working committee and presented for public feedback last February. Through public feedback, it was determined that preserving an historic building in the area is a top priority, as is creating learning spaces that allow for kindergarten to grade 9 arts core programming. A design concept was approved that will see a full modernization of the historic Highlands School with an addition to provide added space and full accessibility. This design concept is now awaiting funding as our number one priority ask in our 3-year capital plan. Each of these processes took a different path based on the needs and the desires of each community. As each mature area in the city has its own unique needs, we are prepared to work together through a process that will produce viable, responsive solutions to the challenges faced. If we were to replicate the process used in the Highlands Review, the timeline could look like this. Our first meeting tonight, a second meeting in May to share more information and to begin to explore options based on your feedback here tonight. An update to the board in June, the establishment of a community working committee in the fall, with final public engagement next January on design options. This process could also move faster than this, as it did in the Lawton cluster area. Each cluster community will take us on a journey that meets their unique needs. The second set of arrows in red at the bottom show the beginning of a process with other mature communities across our city to begin in 2017. We invite you now to take part in a facilitated small group discussion to share the needs and desires of your community. Participation in the breakout sessions is optional. So if you do not wish to stay, please visit our website and survey to provide your feedback. Your voice is very important. When you arrived, you received a handout with a map of the school on it. On the map, one classroom has been highlighted. At the end of this presentation, please go directly to the room assigned. Each room has been assigned a facilitator. These facilitators are principals and other district leadership staff. Each room will have a note taker to capture your thoughts, feelings, and ideas for our records. In order to allow for an even distribution of people in each room, please attend in the room assigned. We have student leaders on hand to provide assistance in finding your rooms. They are all on the second floor, so if you are unable to access your room via stairs, an elevator is available. Please see one of the student leaders for assistance. If you did not receive a map when you walked into the presentation, we have Mr. Sloan at the back. He will provide you with one. As I'm sure you have many questions, staff from planning, facilities, and student transportation will circulate throughout the rooms this evening to answer your questions. Once again, thank you for being here this evening.